Can I share my screen now?
Yes, you can share.
Yeah. And once I start sharing my screen, and once I start my presentation, probably I will not be able to see participants. So if there is any problem, you can let me know.
Sure. Right?
And in between, if you can speak some words or some even sounds, that will be good for me. I will know that somebody is listening. Because sure. I believe all the participants are asked to keep their microphones muted. And
yes,
even
sir.
Videos are also not on. So no worries. But anyone can disturb me anytime. Whenever you feel that there is a question and if you want an answer, please stop me. Okay, please don't hesitate. We will
sure.
be together for around 1 hour and 10 minutes or so. Right.
Yes,
and,
sir. Yes.
I believe participants have something to write on a piece of paper and a pen, because ultimately we are going to talk about writing. So there may be some activities in which I will ask participants to do something. So please treat this as a workshop. And we will begin this workshop, but we will not end this, because once you begin, it is a lifelong process, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So with that background, let's start. Is the font size big enough?
Yes, sir.
Fine. So that was in fact the last slide, and this is the first slide. I'm sure the title is a little intriguing. Write, write. So both these words are pronounced in the same way, but because they are written differently, they mean different things, right? So let's begin. Instead of going for the whole, you know, screen presentation, I will just go for this kind of slide if it is big enough.
Yes, sir. Everything is visible properly.
Perfect. Okay, now let's begin. I would like you, dear participants, to compare the two sentences. And I would like one of you to make it clear to the others. Okay, if you read these two sentences, do they mean the same thing or different? And if different, then what is the difference? Anyone can try. Anyone who is attending this meeting can try. Anyone, would you like to try?
Sir, comma, and then comma.
Okay. So what is the difference in meaning? Is there a difference in meaning between the two sentences, or are they the same?
Sir,
yeah,
I guess the first one states that Bill Gates as well as Richard Branson told differently. They use this statement differently. Two different persons are not using at a time, they are using differently. And the second statement, it means the same, but it is like they both are telling together the same thing, but together.
Okay. Now, let me give you a hint. The hint is There is only one person speaking this sentence. So the whole is spoken by one person. Now, okay, fine. Now my intention was to generate a kind of curiosity. I want you to pay attention to such small things in language, and in any language, not just in English, in any language, the moment a sound is changed, the meaning is changed. The moment a spelling, a single letter changes, the meaning changes. Right? You know that. Similarly, even if a punctuation mark changes, the meaning changes. The absence of a punctuation marks or the addition, that will change the meaning. And that's why writing is the toughest skill. While speaking, you can make mistakes here or there, no problem. People will understand the meaning. But in writing, if you make a mistake, then very often you throw it as a challenge to your readers, right? And what happens in our day-to-day life language, the same thing happens in our research also, in research writing. I have seen hundreds of research papers and theses, and very often I found that people, they just throw their language. Come on, I have written, now you read. That should not be the attitude. Right from the beginning, you try to keep in mind accuracy, brevity, and clarity. These are the three things that will give you a good command of writing. Then only you will be able to generate taut writing. You know the expression taut? Let me show my dictionary also. I'll use my dictionary again and again, and I will share it with you so you can also have a look at it. The word that I used was not the past tense of teach, but it is T-A-U-T, taut. Taut means tight or completely stretched, right? And it is also used for writing. For example, here. I hope you can see my screen.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Taut writing or speech is controlled, clear, and short. So this is our target. We want to achieve this in our writing, whether it is business writing, general writing, social writing, or research writing, right? So taut writing, where every word is important. In speaking, you can take liberty. You can speak 10 words in place of one, but in writing, no. Because the more you write, the more you are going to create problems for your readers and maybe later on for yourself. So let's go back to our first quiz. Here, I'm sure you've seen that after Bill Gates, there is a comma in the first sentence. Whereas in the second sentence, there is no comma after Bill Gates. That means in the first sentence, the speaker or the writer says that the most important people in my life are number one, my parents, number two, Bill Gates, and number three, Richard Branson. So these are the three groups of people. One, my parents, second, Bill Gates, and second, and third, Richard Branson. So these three are individual identities, and they are important for me. In the second sentence, the writer has not added a comma after Bill Gates, and that conveys a totally different meaning. And here the writer by mistake says that the most important people in my life are only my parents. And who are my parents? Bill Gates and Richard Branson. Now you can understand how awkward this sentence is, right? And how dangerous it sounds. Bill Gates and Richard Branson, they are not that writer's parents, right? Now you might have a feeling that, so what? A comma here or there, what difference does it make, right? But it does make a difference. And let me show you a couple of slides where a comma has made a huge difference. And it has cost dearly. Let me share that screen. By the way, this comma is called Oxford or a serial comma, right? Sometimes it is important to keep it to differentiate two sentences. Now, Channi, can you read this, please, aloud?
There was a dispute in Canada between Rogers Communications and Bell Elliott. The argument turned on single comma in the 14-page contract. The comma cost $1 million Canadian dollar.
Now you can see, even in business context, when you prepare your draft and if you make a mistake, it might cost you $1 million. And that was an old thing. After that, there was another case. And in that case, there was, the amount was $5 million. Can you imagine? So now I believe I have convinced you that writing with precision is required in every field. Research is no exception, right? So what is my objective today? I want you to either learn or solidify ways of improving your writing skills. Some of the things you already know, some of the things might be new for you, right? So let's see. And what are the contents for today? I'm going to share some of my premises. Now, if premises is a new word, and let me tell you, it is not about the building or the place where you work or study. I'm talking about my fundamental beliefs, something which I'm not going to change easily. That is my premise. Every human being behaves according to his or her premises. So I'm going to share my premises about writing. Then I will also share during the course of our presentation, my struggles. Make have is the title of Hitler's autobiography. So I'm going to share my struggle. Then there'll be some activities for which you will require some pen and paper. And throughout the session, I'll be giving you some guidelines. Because in writing, there are certain rules and certain guidelines. Rules you will get very easily, but guidelines are difficult. They are based on experience. They are based on study of senior writers or professional writers. And then on the basis of that, probably you'll be able to chart your own course. You'll be able to decide your own road ahead. And then finally, obviously, there'll be some question answer session, right? So let me begin with my premises. First of all, let's accept it wholeheartedly that writing is a skill which anyone can develop. There is nothing divine into it, right? Like, if I am not a good singer, however hard I try, I may not be an excellent singer because it is something divine. I cannot change my vocal cords and the box, etc., right? Whereas writing is a skill. Anyone can become an efficient writer. But it is not easy. It demands a lot of time, attention, and effort. And it's a long process. And it begins with what? It begins with efficient reading. So when you read any good quality material, notice how the writer has provided the details, how the writer has presented the data, what punctuation marks are used, why, what word is used, why not this word and that word, right? So such things will make you an efficient reader first, and then you'll become an efficient writer. Then the goal of writing, as I mentioned earlier, ABC. Accuracy, let me write it on the screen so you can remember better. Accuracy, brevity, and clarity. This is my goal, actually. Wherever I go, wherever I speak, wherever I write, my goal in communication is this. Accuracy in terms of the choice of words, accuracy in terms of punctuation marks, accuracy in terms of the sequence, the organization, right? All these things are important. For example, in our field, in English language teaching and research, we follow a particular model. We have two models. One of the two we can decide. When I was a student, we preferred MLA, Modern Languages Association, MLA style. And many, when I went to America, and after that, with when I worked with American scholars, I went for APA style. So I'm sure in your field, you can find out what style is common and then stick to that. So that will give you a good grounding in your writing. Those who are familiar with, not
Excuse
familiar
me, sir.
With this,
Yes, sir. What is that APA style?
As I said, there are different styles of presenting your material in research. So most British and many European countries, they prefer MLA style for arts. Like I am from arts, right? So we prefer MLA, Modern Languages Association. So if you can just Google it, MLA style, okay? So there will be hundreds of websites telling you what it is. So for arts and history, we follow this particular style. So in this style, there are books written to teachers how to cite somebody's source, how to prepare a bibliography, how to quote something, how to quote an electronic source. So all such things are given in MLA style. Similarly, there is another style which is more common in America, which is APA style. Right, so you can Google and see what these styles are in your field. There may be some other styles, so your guides can help you with that, but stick to one particular style right from the beginning. Even if you are writing in your notebook, right, when you are making your personal notes, then stick to that particular style so it becomes your habit. Because you know, many students, many researchers, they come to me, for example, they submit their paper. The quality of the paper is excellent, thought-wise, content-wise. But because of their presentation, they are rejected from international publishers. And people there, they don't have time to give you comments on everything that you've written. So they will just say rejected. And very often they don't give any, you know, feedback. So at that time, then they come to me, I look at their paper and I get impressed by their thought content. But the problem is with presentation. They confuse the reader. They use mixed styles. No, stick to one particular style, right? So MLA, APA, or whatever style you prefer for your particular field. You can ask your guides for that. So goal is ABC. That is accuracy in terms of everything. Second is brevity. As I said, for teachers, we are free to use more language than required. But as a researcher, when you are writing, or when even we write for some journal or some professional audience, then we keep it in mind that we don't write more than required, not even a single word. That is brevity, briefness. And I'm sure you heard that proverb, brevity is the soul of wit. That's the ultimate test. There are many interesting examples actually, but right now I'm avoiding them because we have a very limited time. So brevity, very important. Then clarity. Sometimes people, they are so much, you know, obsessed with brevity, and they write in such language, cryptic language, people don't understand what the message is. So that is also not good. We have to balance. Brevity is important. Clarity is equally important. And to generate or to achieve clarity, there are many devices that your language offers. For example, punctuation marks. Why are they there? Not for teachers or not for, you know, marking papers. They are for clarity. Right? So this is our goal: accuracy, brevity, and clarity. Now you might ask me how to achieve this. And the simple answer is, first was reading efficient writers and then learning from them and then creating your own draft and then editing it. But how to edit? You know, editing is one of the most difficult tasks, and that's why it is grossly neglected at all levels. So what you require is ruthless editing. Right, ruthless. And how can you do that? By performing this A, B, C, D. Now let me tell you what they are. This is for editing. A, B, C, and D for editing, which people, not just me, but many people in the world, when they really edit, they use this. A is for adding. You know, sometimes you have written the whole thing, your draft is over, but then when you reread, you feel that there is some confusion here. My reader may find it difficult to understand. So you add something. It may be some piece of information, some data, some linguistic device, right? Cohesive markers like though, although, even though, therefore, hence. Sorry. So you add. Then sometimes you budge. Budge means actually move. And all these things are possible only after you have prepared your first draft. Then only you will understand the whole thing and you will be able to decide, should I keep it here or there? Is this word here all right, or should I keep it at the end of a word, of a sentence? So you move things here and there for coherence, right? Ultimately, you want to achieve what? Coherence. You want to achieve taut writing, taut prose, right? You want to make an impact on the reader. There are different ways of saying what your goals are. Then C is you change. You know, this is apparently it's very simple. You change one word from here to there. But it is so important because sometimes just one word can spoil the entire thing, right? Sometimes one sentence can create a problem for you. If you read recent newspaper articles, you will know it better. Some people, they make some statements and then they're in trouble. Sometimes they make a statement in the morning and we do that statement in the evening, but still they're in trouble. So it is better to change the word that might cause problems for others. And the last but not least is delete. You know, one of the most difficult tasks for a writer is to delete his or her own words. So once we create, we feel that it is our property, like our children. We don't want to delete them. But no, ideally, after you perform this A, B, C, D, your draft should be 1/3. Okay, 1/3. So after every 3 words, you have to delete 2 words and 1 word should be left. If you can do that kind of ruthless editing, then only your paper, your thesis will be robust, very strong. Nobody can challenge that, right? It will have that impact. Are you all with me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yes.
You can stop me and ask me any question anytime. Please feel free. Yeah, you can unmute and ask whenever you want. Because I believe in now or never. The next is, this is again one of my premises. We can never do enough to improve our writing, right? For any language, for example, it's a constant lifelong process. And if you want to try or experience that, you write a paragraph, you look at that paragraph after 3 days, you edit it, you look at that paragraph after another 3 days, and you will still feel that yes, it can be edited. It's a long-term process and you can never do enough, right? Now, what is writing? If you see it from a child's point of view, a layman's point of view, writing is nothing but words and structure. In any language, ultimately you have words and you words put words together. That's it, structure. In fact, in some language, there is no structure also. Structure is not important. For example, can you give an example of a language where structure is not important? Any idea? Any language where structure is not important? Or not as important as we have in Indian languages like Gujarati and Hindi or English?
No idea, sir.
Okay. Sanskrit. In Sanskrit, sentence structure is not important. It has a different, you know, pattern of conveying meaning. In Sanskrit, I can say aham swalpam sanskrutam janami, or janami swalpam aham sanskrutam, sanskrutam alpam aham janami. They all mean the same thing, because the meaning of a sentence is not dependent on sentence structure. Whereas in English, Mukesh killed Suresh. Can you say Suresh killed Mukesh? No, not possible, because English is a structure sensitive language. So ultimately, what you have vocabulary of a language, and then you have grammar of that language. So in our case, English vocabulary and English grammar. That's what is writing all about, right? Now let's start with words. You must understand that a word in isolation has no meaning at all. Probably it has meaning potential. That means it can mean A, B, C, D, E, F, or G, like that. It has meaning potential, but not fixed meaning. For example, if I ask you, what is the meaning of the word point? Now you don't have to answer. Just think about the meanings possible. Somebody may be thinking about a point of a needle, right? Somebody may be thinking about, that's a valid point. Somebody may be thinking about this point and shoot camera. Somebody might be thinking about that pointing at somebody, right? So the word point as such has no fixed meaning, right? So point can mean any of these things, and these things are taken from Macmillan Dictionary, right? It can be an idea, it can be just an aspect, it can be a particular time, for example, at that point of time, it can be a place, right? It can be a unit, it can be an area of light or color, sharp end of something, piece of land. So all these are dictionary meanings, possible meanings of the word point. And still narrow it, still the meaning can be narrowed if you use it in a particular phrase, for example, like this. So when you say at some point, it has a fixed meaning. Somebody might say, come on, get to the point now. I see your point. Make a point of noting down all the important points. That's another point, right? How will you prove your point? On point. For example, his speech was on point. On point means perfect. His writing was on point, right? And please say everything to the point, nothing extra. Up to a point, I agree with you, right? So now you can see the word point doesn't have any fixed meaning. It depends on the context. So there are two things that give meaning actually. I will write down, I'll type it here. What gives you meaning? Context and co-text. Context is the situation in which you are using it, right? And co-text is the words before and after that particular word in question, right? Are you with me? Any query, any suggestion, any doubt?
Very so.
Okay. Now, one step ahead. We have looked at the importance of vocabulary, and there are so many ways to improve your vocabulary. And then you have to see the difference between formal and informal also. For example, when you're writing a research paper, you will not use a word like a cop. You will say a policeman, right? You will not say husband, like that. So formal, informal, You will not say my computer was on the blink. No, my computer was not functioning properly. So research writing will require formal expressions. You know all these technical things. You know what I'm trying to do is I'm keeping the things which are easily available away. You read any book on research writing and you will get all those things. What you will not get is actually the fundamental thing, the what is accurate, what is acceptable, what is not acceptable. So now I would like you to use your pen and paper and answer questions to my next slide. In the next slide, I am going to give you 10 sentences, 10. And I would like you to correct them where necessary. That means each and every sentence is not wrong. Don't start correcting everything. There may be some sentences perfectly acceptable, right? And all those sentences are based on very simple primary English language. There is nothing highfalutin or something very abstruse. No, simple, very simple. So please grab a piece of paper and a pen. And I'll give you 3-4 minutes to do this task. Okay, are you ready?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Fine. Okay, I believe you tried once at least. Yes, shall we start?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Even if you have not done each and every sentence, don't worry. I am more interested in discussing the concept rather than individual sentences, right? So according to is always used for others' opinions. That's it. So you can say according to the teacher, according to the latest news, according to the Bible, the Quran, the Gita, according to my neighbor, according to Dharmendra Sheth, that's fine. But when you want to give your opinion, there are three possibilities. You can say, In my opinion, or to my mind. These are the three common ones. You can obviously say, I think, right? But according to is not used for our own opinions. Is that clear? Now you can ask me why.
Yes, sir.
You can ask me why.
Why, sir?
Because English is English. There is no logic sometimes. Right from the first letter of the English language, there is no logic. Let me prove it. Say, what is the first letter of the English alphabet? What is the first letter of the English alphabet?
A.
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 Now, the letter A, when you speak it in isolation, it is A. But when you use it in a word, it will become, in this word, A, as in apple. A, as in ask. O, as in all. A, as in able. A, as in ability. Now, what is the logic? No logic at all. Any sound can have, any letter can have any sound in a word. No logic at all. For example, letter U. In P-U-T, you say as put, U as in put. In B-U-T, it is A as in but. And in B-U-R-Y, it is A as in berry. What is the logic? Nothing. Letter T, as in nature, ch, nation, sh, in T, th, and in listen, silent, it has disappeared. That means there is no logic right from the first letter in the English alphabet. And the same happens with words, same happens with even, grammatical structures. So you just have to flood yourself with good quality language. That is the key to success in language study in English. So let's go to the second sentence. Second sentence says, this is one of the. Now one of, that means you are taking one from a group. So that group has to be in plural. Surat is one of the best cities to live in. This is one of the best ideas. So answer should be ideas, S at the end, plural form, right? Have you understood? One of the best is always followed by a plural noun. Because you are taking one from a group. If I say Channi is the best student, then Meet will say, what about me? I am also a good student. Darshil will say, I am also a good student. So there will be a quarrel. So to avoid that quarrel, I will say Channi is one of the best students. Then others will say, okay, I am also included in that. So structures make a lot of difference in the meaning. Right? So one of the best ideas. Third sentence. Now, third sentence is about word grammar. Now, this may be a very, a little strange concept for you. Our entire life, we study sentence grammar, like tenses and voice and active passive, direct indirect speech, you know. So people, when they think of grammar, they always think about sentences. But apart from that, in fact, I would say 60 to 70% of language requires word grammar. Every word has its own grammar. Let me give you a couple of examples. Prefer something and something. Suppose I want to compare tea and coffee. Okay. So I like, for example, tea. I don't like coffee. So what will I say? I prefer tea. Can anyone complete the sentence? I'm comparing tea and coffee. My preference
over is coffee.
Over coffee.
Over coffee.
Now remember, over is not used here. Prefer is always followed by to. Now Meet, you can ask me why.
Why, sir?
Because English is English. The same answer for all why questions. Prefer is followed by T when you are comparing two things. That's it. Right? So another example of word grammar. Say, I enjoy to meet or meeting people. Which one is correct?
Meeting.
Why? Because enjoy is always followed by the ing form. That's it. So this is about word grammar. Every word in English has a fixed grammar. And we have to respect that. So in this sentence, provide has its own grammar. Provide something. No, provide somebody with something. For example, I will provide you, for example, your professor can say, lecturer can say, I will provide you with all the material required.
Okay, sir.
Right? The hotel will provide you with all the basic necessities. So provide is followed by provide me with everything. Right? Now I'm sure you will not ask me why, because you know the answer. Right. fourth sentence. Fourth sentence has a phrase look forward to. And the phrase look forward to is always followed by the ing form. So I look forward to meeting you. When you write an application, at the end you write, I look forward to getting a positive reply. I look forward to getting an interview call, right? When you are a business person, for example, and you want to work with Larsen & Toubro, you want to supply something to Larsen & Toubro. So you can say, we look forward to serving you, right? So keep ing form here. Fifth, here again, suggest is like enjoy. So enjoy, suggest, consider, then there are quite a few, deny, right? These verbs and many other such verbs are followed by the ing form, right? So you can say, I suggest consulting, not to consult, consulting a specialist. I suggest buying a good dictionary, right? Next, six. Now this sentence, I had my hair cut before calling her. This is a perfectly acceptable sentence, because here the first had is for past of past. That's the principal use of the word had in grammar. For example, I had finished my two sessions before I started your session. I had taken tea before I started today's session with you. So had is past of past. That is clear here. And have my hair cut, that is the phrase which we want to use. So I had my hair cut before calling her. Perfectly acceptable, no problem. Seventh, in comparison, when you have an ER form, by the way, comparison is very important for research writing. Any research writing will require comparative structures. So you must master all the comparative structures possible. And on our website, if you go, there'll be many videos and audio and text material for many important areas of English, right? And everything is free on our website. You don't have to register. You don't have to give your mobile, nothing. Everything is free. More is comparative form. Safer is also comparative form. Two comparative forms can never come together in English. You can't say more better. You can't say more faster. No. Whenever ER form or comparative form is available, you have to use that only. So it's safer to drive during the day. It is faster to travel by plane, right? So where is more required then? More is required when the comparative form is not available with ER. For example, hardworking or honest. So for honest, we can't say honester. A is honester than B. No, A is more honest than B. So wherever ER forms are not available, at that time you require more and most for comparative and superlative. Okay. Remember this. This is a typical Indian problem. Number eight. One of the principal rules of the English language is whenever there is a time clause means clauses with when or till or until or after or before. These are time clauses. And whenever a time clause refers to a future time, we don't use future tense. We use simple present. So when she comes, not will come, but when she comes. When she comes, we will start our work. As soon as he comes, we will start our work. You can go home as soon as she comes. Wait here till she comes. So till she comes, after she comes, when she comes, as soon as she comes, these are all for future time. But the tense is not future. The tense is a simple present tense. That is one of the rules of the English language. And number 8 is perfectly acceptable. No problem. I do different things at different times. That's fine. Here, first do is for emphasis. Suppose you say, do you speak Gujarati? I do speak Gujarati. That's my mother tongue. So I do speak Gujarati. So that do is for emphasis. Similarly, if somebody asks, do you do different things at different times? Of course, I do different things. What do you mean? I do different things at different times. So that's a perfectly acceptable sentence. And number 10, in research writing, one of the commonest problems is plural, singular plural. Now, there are many nouns in English. They are category nouns. They cannot be converted into plural forms. One of them is equipment. Equipment is a group noun. It is a category noun. You cannot convert it into plural. When you say, I want to buy some medical equipment, that means there are many things under that umbrella term, equipment. Let me make it easier to understand. If you use the word furniture, when you go to somebody's house, do you say, I like the furnitures in your house? No. You say, I like the furniture in your house. No SES. Because it's a category noun. And inside that, there may be many items. For example, a piece of furniture, a chair, a sofa set, like that. Okay. So these are the answers. You can confirm with your worksheet. Check them. And if you have any doubt, you can ask me.
Yes, sir. I'm having a doubt in the number 9.
Meet, 1 minute. Last time also I wanted to say, but I didn't have time. But now, since it is repeated, I'm saying the word have, possess, consist, contain, belong to, okay, own, etc. These verbs, when they indicate possession, they do not take the ing form. So I have a doubt. Okay. I have a doubt, I have a query, I have a problem, I have a house. So no ing. I am having a dictionary. No, I have a dictionary. Okay, now go ahead. Please.
Yes, sir. So in the number 9th, where you say that we use to do in the sentence, in the same sentence. So yes. What if, like, someone asked me, why were you late? And I got to say that, I do different things at different times. That's why
that
I was late.
That is a normal statement. That is a non-emphatic statement. For example, if you ask me, do you believe in God? And I can say, yes, I believe in God. That is neutral, normal.
Yes.
But suppose I am going to a temple, I have a big, you know, mark on my forehead, I have a special dish in my hand with a lamp and with a matchstick and some other things. And if I am going to a temple, you can see that temple, you can see me, and then you say, do you believe in God? Now, what will I say? Well, can't you see? I have all these things, a special kind of dress and these things. So I do believe in God. So do is for more emphasis. What's your first language?
It's Gujarati.
Gujarati. Can you speak, do you speak Gujarati at home?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so yes is normal. But if you want to make it more emphatic, I do speak or we do speak Gujarati at home. That is for emphasis.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Any other doubt, anyone?
Sir, in sentence number 5, I suggest, comma, consult a doctor or consult a specialist.
That will be a spoken thing, right? It will be in spoken form. But that will also be very awkward in speaking, because even in speaking, suppose you are telling a friend, Suppose you have a friend and that person has not been keeping well for the last 10 days, right? And that person has not consulted a doctor. Then what do you say? I suggest you, and then the main verb, consult a doctor. And in your mind, you will say before you die. Right? So I suggest you consult a doctor. That is more for speech. After I suggest, you don't put a comma. That's never used in English. Right?
Okay, sir. Okay.
Any other? Don't take any doubts home. You can ask me anything. I guarantee I will listen to all your questions, but I don't guarantee I will answer all the questions. We'll try to find out. Anyone? Okay. You can ask me later on also. You have my number and email and everything. No worries. Next. Channi, do we have about 5-10 minutes?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, the last task. The last task is to put everything together. Whatever we have discussed so far, we want to put everything together. So on the screen, I will show you a paragraph, which is not a nicely written paragraph. I want you to make it better. Now, since we don't have a lot of time, I would just like you to read it carefully and I will directly give you the answer. But you think about it. How will you make it easier, clearer, better, taught, right? Effective. So this is the paragraph. Okay, if you have read it, I give you 2 minutes. Can you please write down and make this easy for the reader? Okay, this is your task. In 2-3 minutes, try. Okay, now since we are a little late, we are running out of time, I will tell you the process. You have your answer with you, whatever you have written, no worries. But after reading the first draft, what you can do is you can remove whatever is unnecessary, which we call cut per page. So all unnecessary words and phrases, all repetitions I have removed, and wherever possible, I have made it shorter. Right? So you can see in place of organizers of the, you can just say organizers, event organizers. So you are saving 2 words here, right? Then you can say from the point of view of is repeated. So in place of that, I can write by. So it will save my lots of words. Then when you save, they are going to burn ultimately, right? This is, I'm sure you understand the concept. Here there is some fire, they create some fire. Now when you burn something, obviously you will use discarded things. You will not take sofa from your house and give it for holy celebration to burn. No. So discarded word is not required. And if something is dangerous, it is bound to be unacceptable. So what is the point of using unacceptably dangerous? Is there anything which is acceptably dangerous? Right? Not possible. Then to the possible danger of people attending the event, does this phrase add any value to your overall guidelines? Nothing. We are talking about danger to people only. We are not talking about animals. And we are not talking about all the people in the world. We are talking about the people who are attending the event. Right? So after removing all the unnecessary stuff, when you rewrite, it will become like this. This is the revised draft. So the event organizers should try to achieve greater safety by ensuring that the bonfire does not contain any dangerous materials such as this, and that fireworks are let off only in the designated area, not randomly here and there, only where it is allowed. And easily identifiable warden should be present to prevent people from letting off fireworks indiscriminately. That means some people like volunteers, they should be there and they should be easily identifiable. Now, I am still not happy with this draft. Why? Because there is less clarity. People, when they read, they are not able to understand immediately how many points there are. And clearly, there are how many points? 1, 2, and 3. So I can revise it like this. Final draft. The organizers of the event should try to achieve greater safety by ensuring that A this, B this, and C this. Now, does it look easier to understand?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So now you compare it with the first draft and you will see how dangerous it was, how complicated it was, how confusing it was, and how uninviting it was. And the final draft, very easy to understand. Even without reading, you know that there are three important points. Right? This is what I mean by accuracy, brevity, and clarity. Right? So final list, if you are an efficient writer, you have to keep in mind all these things, which I am copying actually because of times, because of the limitations of time. I am sharing it with you via chat box, so you can copy paste if you want. But in brief, after you have written, you know, after your first draft is over, you have to check whether you have used apt words. Apt means appropriate. Have you avoided repeating any point or words? Have I avoided ambiguity? Are there any convoluted? Convoluted means very complex, intricate, difficult to understand. Are my tenses consistent? Does my writing reflect clear and logical thinking? Have I used proper cohesive devices or signposts like on the whole, despite, in spite of, instead of? These are all cohesive devices, joining devices. Then punctuation marks. There can be a separate program on punctuation marks. Then formality, tone, format, conventions of writing. For example, how you write date, how you write numbers, right? And finally, have I ruthlessly edited my draft? Okay. So I hope I have not taken more time than expected.
No, sir. Indeed, it was a very interesting and brainstorming session, I guess.
Thank you. Any question, anyone, if you want to, if you have time.